First, it really is my pleasure to introduce, again, part of a distinguished panel of experts today, Hannibal B. Johnson, who is a graduate of Harvard Law School, is an author, attorney, and consultant specializing in diversity and inclusion. He is also a university professor and prolific author, including a focus on the history of the Greenwood District. His books include Black Wall Street, From Riot to Renaissance in Tulsa's Historic Greenwood District, and Tulsa's Historic Greenwood District. Not only can you get those at bookshop.org, or which always supports your local bookstore, some of those you can also locate on your local library app. So again, encourage you to go take a look at those resources. In addition, Dr. Johnson serves as the Education Committee Chair on the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre Centennial Commission. Hannibal, thank you so much for being with us.
It's great to be here.
Well, World War I certainly presents a unique opportunity to the nation and difficult questions for individuals across the United States to answer. And one of those key ones, for example, was, should a black man serve in the United States Armed Forces that was fighting to make the world safe for democracy, when democracy may not necessarily have been safe for the black community throughout the United States? I'm not going to spend much time talking about the experiences of World War I. But if you want to find out more information, please feel free to go to this website, worldwaronechangedus.org. There is a 7-minute long video along with a variety of other resources that you can take a look at that can help and very briefly share some of that story. We also have an online collections database that has some images that bring personal faces to these questions. And you can see some of the answers that individuals, and you can read about some of those individual stories. Despite that question about full citizenship and making the nation and the world safe for democracy, African American communities are going to raise $250 million in war bonds, largely led by a number of women's organizations who not only supported the war effort in fundraising, they also served in a variety of ways, as you saw by the woman driver in the last picture, but they will also serve as nurses, as essential volunteer organizational roles, like in the YMCA. There will be two female volunteers who are serving overseas in Europe as well. By 1919, nearly 1 million African Americans are going to leave the rural South for opportunities in the North in war industries, metalworking industries, and shipbuilding. And that is where my knowledge base really ends and hopefully sets us all up for this conversation. And really, Hannibal, can you set the stage for us as we head into a conversation today about what is happening in Tulsa and the Tulsa Race Massacre? What's the environment like in 1920 around the nation?
Well, you know, historians and sociologists often refer to this period as the nadir of race relations in America. Nadir is a word that means the low point. So they use this language because of really two essential things. One is the proliferation of what were called race riots during this period. James Weldon Johnson of the NAACP called the summer and fall of 1919 Red Summer. Red is a metaphorical reference to the blood that flowed in the streets from all this civil unrest in these events called race riots. Simultaneously, across the nation, there was an outbreak that extended for many years thereafter of lynching. Lynching is a form of domestic terrorism. Lynching is a mechanism whereby white supremacy is reinforced. Most of the lynching targets or victims are black folks, particularly black men. And the point of the lynching, the point of the brutalization of these black men, was not simply for retribution with respect to those individuals, but rather to send a message to the group of African Americans, the collective African American community, about their relative place in society. So this atmosphere that's suffused with lynching and with these so-called race riots is most inhospitable for people of African ancestry in America in 1920. Yet despite this abject, overt kind of hostility, there were a number of remarkable successes throughout the nation, not the least of which occurred here in Tulsa, Oklahoma, on Greenwood Avenue, in a place that was fondly dubbed Black Wall Street.
Now, I believe that was, and we were talking about this earlier today, that was Booker T. Washington in some way. So this is a well-known part of the nation in 1920, 1921. There are a lot of national and, well, can you tell us a little bit more about what Greenwood, Oklahoma was like, or the Greenwood District of Tulsa was like in 1920, 1921?
So the Greenwood District in Tulsa in 1920, 1921 is a segregated Black community that roughly abuts downtown Tulsa, separated by the Frisco tracks. It's about a 35 square block area. And it is a community of necessity. The reason the Greenwood community exists in the first instance is because the mainstream economy and community was essentially closed off to African Americans. So they built their own sort of oasis in this area that just is, again, north of downtown, separated by the Frisco tracks. So you could come to the Greenwood District and you could find what I consider to be a Black Main Street, which is a conglomeration of small businesses, sole proprietorships, service providers. So you could find movie theaters, dance halls, pool halls, barber shops, beauty salons, hotels, jitney services, cleaners, pharmacies, grocery stores, restaurants, doctor's offices, lawyer's offices, dentist offices. It's just kind of a smorgasbord of services and goods that people need on a day-to-day basis. It was an insular economy supported in part by the fact that Oklahoma, formerly Indian territory, has these unique ties to the so-called five civilized tribes, the Cherokees, Muscogee Creeks, Choctaw, Chickasaw, and Seminole Nations. Now, all the five tribes engaged in the practice of chattel slavery. So all the five tribes had folks within their midst, some free, some enslaved, who were of African ancestry. So the forced migration of those tribes in the 1830s and 1840s from the southeastern United States included people of African ancestry. The five tribes sided with the Confederacy during the Civil War. As a result, they executed treaties with the federal government post-Civil War. And with respect to four of the five tribes, the Chickasaws being the exception, the tribes agreed to incorporate their formerly enslaved persons as citizens of the tribes. The other thing that happened was that tribal members during the allotment process in the latter part of the 1900s and the early part of the 2000s, tribal communal land was broken up into individual parcels. Mm-hmm. In other words, the federal government had an interest at the time in breaking up these tribal nations. So they allotted individual parcels of land. Well, the formerly enslaved persons and their progeny received land allotments as well. Land allotments, you can imagine, in the late 1800s, early 1900s, land is essentially an accession to wealth. So we have these relatively well-off Black folks in Oklahoma who helped contribute to the success of communities like the Black community in Tulsa, successful Black business community in Muskogee, Oklahoma, and successful Black communities that were all black communities, like Boley, Clearview, Langston. Oklahoma had more than 50 of these all black towns, as they were called, throughout its history. So the Greenwood District was prominent and was dubbed Black Wall Street because of the economic and entrepreneurial activity that was concentrated here in this segregated portion of Tulsa, Oklahoma.
If this is taught in a textbook, which this moment in history was not included in the textbooks that I taught from, it may be known as the Tulsa Race Riot. It is much more appropriately called the Tulsa Race Massacre. We'll get to that important name variation a little later on in our conversation. What are the national and those local causes that lead to the catalyst of this moment?
You know, it's important to talk about that national context. I've sort of described the national context in terms of structural systemic racism that was endemic in the United States during the period. That's certainly part of the puzzle. Locally, land lust was a factor. I mentioned that the Greenwood community roughly abutted downtown, separated by the Frisco tracks. So we know that there were corporate and railroad interests that wanted the land on which the black community sat. They wanted to move the black community farther north. We know that the Klan, the infamous domestic terrorist organization, the Ku Klux Klan, had a strong presence in Oklahoma and in Tulsa in the 1920s, beginning in the early 1920s and really peaking in the late 1920s. And then add to that combustible mix, the media. Very interesting that we talk about and we focus on the role of the media today in terms of race relations and other kinds of domestic and international issues. The media were no less important back in the day. And there was one particular media outlet, a daily afternoon newspaper called the Tulsa Tribune, that published a series of articles and editorials that really fomented hostility in the white community against the black community. So those are some of the factors that led Tulsa to be in 1921, in the run up to the massacre, a tinderbox or a powder keg needing only some sort of catalyst or igniter to set the community alight.
And it's not unique just to Tulsa, as some of you may have joined us in other lectures or in other webinars in 1919 and in 1920. In 1919, that summer is known as the Red Summer. There are actually at least 11 veterans of the World War who are lynched in uniform. This is just regardless of your service, you are seen because of your race. And there are a lot of important national stories. So depending upon where you are joining us from, that may be an important thing to be looking into as well in your local communities. Go ahead.
Let me say one more thing about service in World War I and World War II, but we're focusing on World War I. So one of the supreme ironies here with the war is that many black men were willing to go to war to prove their patriotism and their humanity to the larger white society. And they found that when they were abroad, they were treated with more humanity than they were at home. They were therefore emboldened and empowered when they got home to challenge the systems that oppressed them. Those challenges resulted in a vicious backlash, which is part of what lynching is all about.
Now, let's talk about that, what becomes a horrific backlash in the city of Tulsa itself. You mentioned that this was already nationally the tinderbox. What occurs in 1921 that is that flashpoint?
Yeah, there's a catalytic event that involves two teenagers. A black boy who's 19, he's trying to choose downtown. A white girl, 17, who runs an elevator in a downtown building. So this begins on Monday, May 30th, 1921, which is Memorial Day. The boy is Dick Rowland. He needs to use the restroom. I've mentioned that Jim Crow was in full force in Tulsa, so his options are limited. He knows that there's a restroom available for his use in a downtown building called the Drexel Building. He walks over to the Drexel Building, enters the elevator, being manually operated by young Sarah Page. Something happens on the elevator. We're not exactly sure what happened, but it causes Dick Rowland accidentally to bump up against or brush up against Sarah Page. Sarah Page begins to scream. She overreacts. The elevator's back in the lobby. Dick Rowland, frightened, runs from the elevator. Sarah Page, distraught, exits the elevator. She's comforted by a store clerk from a locally owned store called Renberg's. She tells him the story of, at least her version of the story of the elevator incident, which we assume involves an assault, as she first told it. That is a story that she would later recant. She refused to testify against Dick Rowland. He was arrested for an assault, put in jail. Now, that may have been the end of the story had it not been for the intervention of the Tulsa Tribune, that daily afternoon newspaper I mentioned earlier. The next day, which is May 31st, the Tribune ran a story captioned, "Nab Negro for Attacking Girl in an Elevator." This is a false narrative about an attempted rape in broad daylight in a public space in downtown Tulsa. The article, if you read it carefully, goes out of its way to make Sarah Page look virtuous, and as a corollary, to make Dick Rowland look villainous. It had its desired effect. As I mentioned, Dick Rowland was arrested. He was taken and put in jail, which is on the top floor of the courthouse. A large white mob began to gather on the lawn of the courthouse. The white mob numbered in the thousands ultimately. A group of black men, several dozen in number, were concerned about Dick Rowland's safety. There were rumors that he was going to be lynched. They marched down to the courthouse to protect him. Some of them were armed. Not surprisingly, conflict ensued. There were words exchanged between the larger white group and the smaller black group. A white man tried to take a black man's gun. And as one of the massacre survivors describes it, all hell broke loose after that. So the upshot of this, after the dust settled, was that some 100 to 300 people lost their lives, most of them black. Hundreds more were injured. At least 1,250 homes were destroyed in the black community. A number of businesses, schools, churches, and library were destroyed as well. Property damage, conservatively estimated at the time, emphasis on that conservative estimate, property damage, $1.5 to $2 million, well over $25 million in today's money. Many black folks were interned, very much like people of Japanese ancestry were interned during World War II. They had to have a green card, an identification card, countersigned by a white person to get them out of these centers. And then finally, the Red Cross was called in from St. Louis to provide relief. Many black families spent days, weeks, and months living in tent cities set up on the charred earth. And that is sort of the essence of what happened. There was, in the immediate outbreak of the massacre, there was intense black resistance. There was a group called the African Blood Brotherhood, a national group who had come to Tulsa to work with the community. But the black men in the Greenwood community, as you might imagine, they were outnumbered, outgunned, overmatched, and so on and so on. So the large, teeming white mob spilled over the Frisco tracks into the Greenwood community, shooting, burning, looting, destroying everything in sight. The community, as you'll see in the photographs that you're showing, was decimated. Almost total destruction of the black community in Tulsa. But it doesn't end there, because the narrative really is about the human spirit. So what's remarkable is the fact that most black people in Tulsa said, "We shall not be moved." They rebounded, they rebuilt, they constructed a community that, as a business community, was actually stronger and bigger at its peak in the early to mid 1940s.
I need to give a thanks to the Tulsa Historical Society, which is where all of these photos come from. And again, here's a picture. And we mentioned that at the beginning, that so much of our history is also just individual stories and individual narratives. And here's an image of John Wesley Williams and his wife, Luella Cotton Williams. You can find out more about that at the Tulsa Historical Society. But Greenwood Rising and the Tulsa Race Massacre Centennial Commission really does focus in on a lot of individual stories as well. Again, we'll talk more about that in just a moment. Now, it is really important. You can see here, right, that the National Guard is pulled out and is called out. And one of the things that I want to point out as well is that in that group of men protecting protecting the gentleman who was being in who was in jail at the time, many, some of them were World War I veterans, if I am not mistaken.
Yes.
So you've got this empowerment, as Hannibal mentioned, that really is in deep conflict with the system that actually trained and empowered and said that you are essential to the winning of this moment that our nation is going to make a presence on the international stage. That there is that idea that we would be making the world safe for democracy, that we would be fighting for the League of Nations internationally, and yet even within our own nation, we have images like this one that are occurring. I did want to point out, as this image came up at a time that you were speaking about a different group of individuals. This is members of the Colored Citizens Relief Committee and the East End Welfare Board. And then this was also an image of some of the American Red Cross. Again, you can find more of those images at the Tulsa Historical Society's website. With that, that actually is a good moment for me to also invite our next speaker here. Michelle Place is the executive director of the Tulsa Historical Society and Museum. She is also a commissioner with the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre Centennial Commission. And while I think I have you both still here in the conversation, I mentioned that question earlier. This is in some textbooks and even in some of the interpretation previously at the Tulsa Historical Society and Museum might have been known as the Tulsa Race Riot, but there is a different name. Could one of you speak to that, not only to the centennial moment, but also the historical importance?
Take it away, Hannibal.
I'll take the first crack at it. You can chime in. So I have a slightly different take on this. Okay. So for me, it's not a binary choice. It's not riot or massacre. It's much more complex than that. So nomenclature is really important. So when we look at the term of art that is race riot, that, you know, that's a term of art, meaning it has a special meaning created in a particular moment in time by a particular group of people. Ask yourself, who created this language? Who was absent from the table when the language was created? What's the significance of the label or the language? And race riot has significance in terms of insurance policies, because many insurance policies had exclusionary clauses based on damage occasioned by riot or civil unrest. Ask yourself, once you know the factual matter, what would you call this event or these events? And then finally, if such an event were to occur today, what would you call it and why? Mm-hmm. So for me, it's the critical thinking around nomenclature that's really important. In fact, it's more important than the ultimate language that you settle on. So what's happened in the community here is really kind of a truncated process that led to people accepting the term massacre. I don't disagree with the word massacre. It's accurate. But so are terms like pogrom, Holocaust, ethnic cleansing, genocide, white riot, which is a specific focus of the word riot. I think there are a number of terms that could apply to these facts. And what's really important is again, that critical thinking process that leads to a particular usage. Michelle?
Okay, so I would agree, and I thank my friend Hannibal, who's helped me personally to walk through that. I think that riot was the term that was used most often in the era. Historically, that was what it was referred to. But I think there's a lot to it, particularly in light of the insurance policies. And when you really understand the magnitude of the people who had insurance policies that then ultimately were denied, their claims were denied because of the nature of it being a riot. And so I think that that's another part of the puzzle, another piece of the puzzle that we need to recognize and to think about our history in those terms. But people have, in Tulsa today, have really strong opinions about whether it was a massacre. For many, that word is too harsh for them. That makes them face it even more, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, and I think that is in part part of what we are doing in many ways, just across the nation as well, is
right.
Taking a look at our histories, taking a look at our memorials, what we choose to memorialize, and the words that we use for it, and part of that does come down as well to the museums and the archives that are kept, and what people in over a century felt was important in telling a narrative for future generations. And there's, again, as I mentioned, there's some really incredible things that you all have at the Tulsa Historical Society Museum. I try to be on brand.
Thank you.
I'm off a little bit. I do try. Yeah. And one of those things really is, and you all do such a phenomenal job of taking this and making it available to a national audience. You have created the Tulsa Race Massacre Traveling Exhibit. Can you talk a little bit more about that and about the ways that it's accessible?
Sure. Before I get to the traveling exhibit, if I could just chime in on about the collection itself. And our understanding of how important it is to not only this city's history, but even internationally, if you will. I'm pretty typical of a Tulsan. I've lived in the community for almost 35 years now, but I had lived here for 15 years, had just gone to work at the Tulsa Historical Society in February of 2001, and I answered the phone. There were only two employees at the time. I answered the phone, and it was a reporter from New Zealand who wanted to talk about the Tulsa Race Riot. And so this is before cell phones, etc. And so I asked if he would call me back in a couple of hours because I wanted to find the right person for him to talk to. So I hung up the phone, turned to my only coworker and said, he wants to talk about, and my coworker said, you don't know, do you? And he proceeded to tell me the story. So I've lived here 15 years. My mindset had immediately gone to 1968, which is my frame of reference in terms of racial unrest across the country. So for my age group, that would have been a very typical thing to do. The reason that I began to receive those calls, not only from New Zealand, but from Paris and Japan and Wilmington, Delaware, and Seattle, Washington, the phone literally was ringing off the wall. And that was because finally, the Oklahoma Commission, there was a commission to study and issue a report on what had happened in 1921. And that had just been released in January, the month before I came to work at the Historical Society. So this was very unusual to me that there had been an event of this magnitude and nobody knew about it, talked about it, etc. So I spent quite a bit of time thinking about it. It was about a week later that a gentleman who had served on that commission and had volunteered with the Historical Society. We did not have a museum at the time. We just were beginning to put a dream into place, if you will, of a permanent place. And so he handed me this box and he said to me, "This is the most important collection that you will have for this museum. These are photographs and documents from the 1921 race riot." And he said, "Guard them with your life." It didn't take me long to understand the magnitude of that. So I would say that since that day in early February of 2001, this institution has understood what that collection meant. And I have done my best to guard it as best I can. I will tell you that all of our staff is committed to not only this story, but others, but we do understand the magnitude. As far as technology progressed and as more interest was coming in, literally globally, of people wanting to do research, whether it was to write a master's thesis, a doctoral dissertation, a eighth grade history teacher in Seattle or whatever, that we could not, as best museum practices, continue to handle these documents because of the wear and tear of them, the exposure to light, et cetera, et cetera. And so it was pretty early on that we made a commitment that we needed to figure out how to make all of this available digitally so that that master's student did not have to travel to Tulsa, Oklahoma on their spring break and make an appointment. And it was all just very time consumptive. So we have done that. I will tell you that we did have and continue to have pushback from the community over it, over this story. And I think that we have to remember, we have to set the scene of the times that this happened and into the 40s, etc. I certainly remember not as much my family, but other families who didn't even want to talk about a divorce, or if there were a teenager who was expecting a child, she was sent off, you know, for how many ever months or whatever. And so it was a time that you didn't want to talk about the bad things. Dr. John Hope Franklin describes it as, "We only want to do happy history." And, you know, how many of your contemporaries don't want to watch the news because of there were bad things? I think it also reflects a time of that has been for eons, where it was the victors who wrote the stories. Mm-hmm. And so that wasn't a victorious thing that happened in Greenwood. And we didn't want to think that it was our families who would have participated in it, et cetera. I think a lot of that carries on today. But I think we are on the cusp of a new age, and that is in that we are realizing we don't have the whole story if you don't listen to all sides of it. And we at the museum and other places are committed to making space for all stories to be told, not just the stories from the victors. So we have had very supportive boards, volunteers who have helped us in these endeavors. And our goal is that everything we have in our community, in our collection regarding Greenwood, Black Wall Street, the race massacre, the rebuilding of Greenwood is available via our website. We are holding nothing back. And another reason for that is that it is an element of trust building within the North Tulsa, our Black community, that we are saying to them, we are holding nothing back. Everything is available. We also know that history is not taught as it should in schools. Lots of reasons for that when you have standardized testing. I know I'm preaching to the choir on these, to these school teachers, but you only have so many hours in the day. And when your local history and your state history is not on that nationalized test, then unless you have an exceptional teacher, you don't have that. So what we're trying to do is make those resources available. Locally and throughout northeastern Oklahoma, we do have this traveling exhibit, which comes from an exhibit we had in our museum. We just transferred it to a different platform, if you will. And so we make it available to whether it's schools or businesses, churches, libraries, and it's pop-up. There's no technology because we don't want an excuse of it didn't work or whatever. So we do loan that out for anywhere from a week to a month. We have multiple copies of it. Foundations have underwritten the cost of that. The Greenwood Cultural Center also has copies. The commission has a copy that they also make available. It dovetails with the curriculum that was produced, and I think you'll hear some more about that coming up, but that was our intent, was that we provide the visual element as well as the appropriate curriculum to go with it.
And I think one of those key points as well is that you can easily download it wherever you are located.
Yes.
In the world. So if you are a teacher who is going back into a classroom setting and you have a board that needs some really good history information, clearly from people who care about the importance of the archive, the importance of the object that tells the story and sharing that out, this is it's a really good resource. Take a look at the Tulsa Historical Society and Museum's website, tulsahistory.org. And Michelle, I'm actually going to, at this point, because that was the best transition, introduce our next guest, Dr. Carlos Hill. He is the department chair and associate professor of African and African American Studies at the University of Oklahoma. He is an expert on racism and race relations and specializes on the history of lynching. He wrote the Cambridge University Press published Beyond the Rope, The Impact of Lynching on Black Culture and Memory, among a multitude of other writings. He also serves on the steering committee of the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre Centennial Commission. Carlos, welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that. Can you see me?
I can.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure because my computer has been acting up a little bit, but I'm glad that you can see me. And I just want to, I mean, I've been listening to this whole conversation and I just want to start by saying my dear brother, Hannibal Johnson, who is the foremost historian on Greenwood and who has a book coming out this upcoming year that's going to help us understand Greenwood even better. And my dear sister, Michelle Place, who is doing such a great work with the Tulsa Historical Society. And I have depended on her and her staff to write the book that I'm writing, which is a photographic history of the race massacre that'll come out in April, that they are truly institutions within Oklahoma, but Tulsa. And I just want to just give love to them because they have helped me so much in understanding this history. I mean, I can talk about this in so many different ways. This is my life's work. I study the history of lynching and racial violence, not just in Oklahoma or Tulsa, but nationally. And I have really sober truths about America that I can share, but I want to focus on Tulsa. And Tulsa was, you know, as Hannibal said, just an example of Black excellence. in the 1920s and even beyond that. And it was destroyed in less than 24 hours. And that community rebuilt itself in less than, and Hannibal can correct me, but probably in less than 2.5 years, Black Wall Street, Greenwood District had rebuilt itself for the most part in 2.5 years, despite the, you know, the attempts to rezone it, attempts to stall rebuilding, they rebuilt. And I know Hannibal knows this because he didn't mention this, but I wish he would have. He's the curator of going to be one of the best museums in the world, Greenwood Rising in Tulsa, Oklahoma, that will groundbreak this summer or later this summer. And then it will be, and it will become one of the great museums in the world that tells the story of Black people shortly thereafter. And he is curating that museum, and it's in great hands with him because he knows the story. He is the premier historian of the Greenwood District. And so there's so much to tell. But I'm just gonna say a few things because I only have a little bit of time. And I will say that for me, I've spent so much time with victims and survivors, reading their stories, narratives, and so forth. And so the answer to your earlier question about why is it important really hits me in certain ways. And I would say that the centennial of the race massacre is about telling the story from the vantage point of victims and survivors. For so many years, the story was told in a different light, outside of and in exclusion of their perspective. And the main reason that I'm writing a book about them is because I wrote a book about the Black perspective on lynching. And I know the ways in which lynching victims' stories had never been told and had been a white supremacist narrative of lynching until this day is still the narrative that we tell, even though we tell it slightly different. And so I was so attracted to Tulsa because I have taught about it well before I was interested in writing a book about it, teaching about it in my classes. But coming to Tulsa, spending time with Hannibal, learning from the Greenwood Cultural Center, learning from the John Ho Franklin Center, learning from Michelle Place and the Tulsa Historical Society, the stories that were not told and that needed to be told in the centennial year, if it was going to be a year of reconciliation and redemption, we had to do something that we had never done, which was put the victims, survivors, and descendants first, and tell their story first. And all other stories can come afterwards, but let's tell those stories first. And that's where I sit. But the work that I do with my dear brother Hannibal is trying to make sure that teachers across the state of Oklahoma, but especially in Tulsa, understand the race massacre. And Hannibal has been a fixture of our summer institute. He has been our primary historian and speaker about Greenwood and Black Wall Street and what happened there. And we have a 5-day summer institute where we take teachers who may or may not know a lot about the race massacre, and we take them and we talk to them about this history not just about what happened in 1921, but also the glorious history of this community before, during, and after. And so teachers leave that space, the Summer Institute, with a deep understanding of, in a 360 understanding of Tulsa. And the key goal for all of the work that we do is that, as Hannibal said, we want them to be, have a different relationship to the community that they had before. Mm-hmm. We want them to have a passion for communicating this history that they may not have had before. We want them to have markers and experiences that they didn't have before. And so a big part of what we do is to take teachers to the Greenwood District and to help them to understand this history through sites connected to it. And probably the most powerful experience that I have had as leading this effort with Hannibal has been taking them to, and I might get emotional here, but taking them to Vernon AME, a church that was nearly destroyed but was not destroyed, and it's still standing. And we have a pastor at Vernon AME who is so in touch with, currently in touch with this history, that can talk about it historically and the present. And taking teachers to this space, this sacred space that's across the street from the Greenwood Cultural Center, that's also an anchor institution for this history, has been phenomenal. And I've learned so much as someone who thinks he knows a lot about this history. I've learned so much from seeing people react, respond to the things that we are making available to teachers who may or may not have been to Tulsa, been to the Greenwood District, or even been to Black Wall Street, at minimum the first two blocks of what it was, a 35 block area. And so all I can say is that the 100th anniversary for me, and I think for the commission and Hannibal and all of us, is about the victims and survivors. Mm-hmm. It's about remembering them and what they did in response to, not what happened to them, but in response to what, I mean, in someone like me who has studied the history of lynching and racial violence, what happened to the Greenwood District in Tulsa is, I mean, it is exceptional. Nothing like it happened in this country. The thousands of white people that entered the district to burn, loot, and kill, the bombardment from the air, the detention. There's nothing a part of the Black experience in terms of racial violence that happened in Tulsa that happened elsewhere in our history. And the 100th anniversary is about remembering that and the people who went through that.
And you make a really important point about perspectives and how there is the actual lived experience and then the work that you have coming out. And remind me, when is your book coming out?
April of 2021.
All right. And the objects that capture that experience, and then our jobs as historians and educators to be sharing those stories and to help people engage, to have that living memory, that living understanding and experience of it, which you all are doing through these teacher workshops on site in Tulsa, which I believe may be happening again next year. I believe that you all went virtual this year. It is happening on site at the Tulsa Historical Society and Museum, with the work that, Michelle, you are doing in caring for these objects, making sure that they're available for people to see. I find it remarkable in some ways that, Michelle, you spoke about the 1960s and 1968, and actually I'll invite Michelle, both you and Hannibal, back to your screens to take part here in some fast Q&A, but you spoke about your experiences in the 1960s, and you've got almost every generation. You have the Civil War. 50 years later, you have World War One. 50 years later, you have these momentous occasion of the civil rights movements of the 1960s, and it continues on. And you know, now again, almost 50 years later, you have these movements that are occurring today, which is this up and coming generation's experience. It is their lived experience of engaging varying narratives, of engaging different perspectives, of a reckoning, I think, Michelle, as you put it, kind of a reckoning with our history as well. I am so deeply appreciative that you all would take part of your day to share about the works and this lifetime of work that you all have been doing. It really is a genuine honor. One of the question that I'm actually going to end us with, this is not the question that you get to answer right now. The question that I'm going to end us with, however, is what is that takeaway? What is that lesson to be drawn from this moment in history, from this centennial commemoration, for this present generation, for this younger generation who is living through and who will be living through that Memorial Day of 2021 and that summer. Before we get to that place, I wanna ask a couple of the other questions that have come up. Kathleen McMahon, wonderful question about what the situation in Greenwood is now. And I think that Dr. Hill spoke to some of that. Michelle or Hannibal, would you want to add anything else?
Yeah, the Greenwood community is much different today than it was in either of its heydays. It's an integrated community. It's a community in which most of the land is not African American owned. It is a community that is focused primarily in terms of the history on acknowledging, celebrating, elevating the history. It's a community in which there is opportunity economically and in terms of entrepreneurship, but it's opportunity that's not specifically focused on Black folks, right? So the community is an amalgam of residential, commercial, educational, entertainment, religious, a variety of different kinds of interest, working on unity and branding and the kinds of things that such districts have to focus on to thrive.
For me today, as I walk through Greenwood, it is walking through history, America's history, because it's very visible. Visitors are often surprised at how little is there of the remaining. It's quite shocking, certainly to me. Urban renewal runs right through the middle of the heart of Greenwood. But I think what Greenwood also says to us is, yes, we've come a long way, but we have much work to do. That's my sense of feeling when I walk in. I have wonderful friendships with people who are equally as committed to telling this story of this amazing point on our planet. We want you to come see, we want you to come learn, and we have much work to do. I think we're living in a very exciting time with the Black Lives Matter movement and the reality of that. My grandmother always said, the more things change, the more they stay the same. A lot of things have changed, but we have work to do. And so come see, come learn. We'd love to have you.
a few other fast questions, and some are even yes-no answers. So, from Stephen Slaughter, did the Tribune or a successor face any sort of reckoning for its part in stoking tensions? And I think I know the answer to this, but I give that over to either one of you to say yes or no to.
No.
No.
And then a far more difficult question with a potentially longer answer. With as many victims, Hannibal, as you alluded to, and also a number that varies so widely, were these victims buried in a mass grave? If not, do we know where?
Well, we don't know the answer to these questions, and we may never know. The good news is that we have a mayor who's really invested in this history, and he reignited a mass graves investigation process, choosing those words carefully. So the idea is to follow up on historical leads about mass graves. There have been persistent, credible stories about mass graves from people who claim to be eyewitnesses, from just oral histories and so forth. So the idea is to look into those stories. We've even begun excavations at one particular site called Oaklawn Cemetery. There are other potential sites as well. But we know that we'll never definitively come to a conclusion as to the number of deceased because of poor record keeping, because we know that people were injured and left town, perhaps for treatment, but those people may have passed away elsewhere. We know that even family members may have buried their relatives in a really summary way after the violence. So there are all sorts of reasons that we're unlikely to know the exact numbers. But the point is, as a community, as a mayor so accurately, I think, and appropriately says, we have an obligation. We have a bunch of murders that occurred here in 1921. And we have an obligation as a community to find out what happened to those people. To the extent that we can find out and find remains, we have an obligation to give them their due and the respect that they deserve in interring those remains.
I, working most of my time within the time frame of World War I, do understand that difficulty of the numbers and the like. And I am so deeply moved as well by your city that Oklahoma would, when this came about and the report was actually made and published, that started that international story. Michelle, that you would, that the gentleman who had that box, kept that box and knew not only how important it was, but gathered that information so that we would have this story now, and that Michelle, you and the Tulsa Historical Society and Museum have been stewarding this for decades and making this available for us to be teaching. Hannibal, how you bring life to this story in your written word, in your teaching, in your stewardship and curation of this new museum, and the leading of not only the education committee on this Centennial Commission, but clearly leading voice of the national and the international story on this, advocating for these stories to be told, for us as a present generation to understand the narratives and this moment in history and how it continues to affect us today. Before I give you all the last word, I am going to very quickly mention a couple of other resources that are available to you if you are a teacher on this call. You can go to that website that you just saw right there. There is a 20-minute or so long documentary written and narrated by Hannibal called Black Wall Street Remembered, perfect for a classroom size, something to be doing in some on-demand learning lessons that you might be doing right now. If you are looking for something shorter, there's a 3-minute long video that is out by PBS and the Black Experience in Business. You can check it out on their website. Again, thank you to the United States World War I Centennial Commission for their support in this webinar, as well as so many other resources that we have to look at that narrative of World War I, where we also are trying to find the varying voices, where we look to that global story and where we try to understand how it continues to impact us today. In Washington, D.C. right now, also part of and just going through our own centennial moments, the World War I Centennial Commission is just about completed a national World War I Memorial in D.C. There is no other national World War I Memorial in D.C. And you can check out that in November. You can take a look through it right now in a virtual experience at ww1cc.org. Also, if you want to learn more about the African-American experience in World War I, please go to the website that we partnered with the World War I Centennial Commission on, wwichangedus.org. It looks at a variety of different lenses within which the United States was changed by this moment in history. We also have a resource database because we believe deeply in history education and the importance of the artifact and varying narratives, where soon you will also find these resources that we are talking about today added in as part of the conversation about World War I and the enduring impact of that time frame. You can find lessons, and we also have a newsletter that goes out every other month, again, with the World War I Centennial Commission, so we would invite you to take part. The images I showed earlier today were part of the online collections database, over 40,000 strong at theworldwar.org. You can find them there. And if you want to join in some other webinars, particularly if you want to look a little bit more into the conversations about public memory and important moments in history, and changing our narratives. We've got the webinars that you see on the page in front of you, but in September, on September 10th, we have Oscar-winning film screenwriter, director, producer, Kevin Wilmot, who is going to be joining us online, talking about not only his new film, The 24th, but really talking about how art and film in particular helps us understand history in a different way. So we would invite you to join us for that conversation as well, because again, history is certainly essential, but how we engage that history, what we learn from that history, that is where the real importance can lie much of the time. So I'm going to give the last word to you both, and again, one more time to say I've been so deeply moved by our conversation today. As an educator and as a museum professional, I am just so thoroughly appreciative. Final thoughts?
I think, I always like to close at least a portion of my talks with something profound from Dr. Maya Angelou, and that's this: our history, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, it need not be lived again.
I would like to add that in addition on our site that you would find other resources. Anytime we hear of someone who, even a master's thesis, doctoral dissertation, other books, et cetera, we are happy to link to that. And we would love to see what teachers are doing in their classrooms. So if you would like to share your lessons with us, and to make them available to others, just contact us at the Tulsa Historical Society Museum. We'll add you to our link as a resource. And we'd just love to be able to share your work and share ours. Information, we don't wanna keep it, we wanna share it.
That's the truth of museums and educators alike. We'll be sending out a follow-up email for everyone who is on our Zoom call about those resources, and we will include an email address for you all at the Tulsa Historical Society and Museum. Carlos Hill, Michelle Place, Hannibal Johnson, thank you for an incredible, moving conversation about the Tulsa Race Massacre, about the importance of objects, and about the importance of learning history and commemorating it. It's been a real pleasure to be with you all today. And to you all who are joining us on live now, and to those of you who are joining us later, thank you so much for taking part and wanting to learn and to share.